Good morning, all of you. In today's session, we are going to start with CSIR NET GRF Chemical Science, December 2015, Part C, Series 2. Right? So here, already we completed 2016, 17, 18, 19, 20 academic year question papers of CSIR NET GRF Chemical Science. All are solved in detail, and all solved question papers are available on the channel called World of Competitive Chemistry. This kind of standard previous year question paper discussion will fetching for you towards competitive exams and any other entrance examinations as well. Let us discuss about today's concepts. Today we are going to discuss about CSIR NET GRF Chemical Science, December 2015, Part C, Series 2, consisting question number 81 to 90. So 10 questions are going to be discussed in detail in this session. Question number 81, among the following complexes, the chiral one is R. Okay, so cobalt, tris oxalato was given, trans cobalt Cl2En taken twice was given, chromium EDTA minus charge was given. Among three complexes, which are said to be chiral, that to be predicted. What are the conditions for chirality? Here, in order to assume any compound as chiral, two conditions must be satisfied. One is symmetry elements must not present in the given compound. And the second is the compound is said to be asymmetric. Compound is said to be asymmetric. Okay. When we obey all these parameters, these two parameters, then only the molecule is said to be chiral, right? So when we are taking this cobalt OX taken thrice, tris oxalato compound was taken. Here is the chelate ring between cobalt and oxalato. So chelation is possible so that here the molecule is not said to be a symmetric molecule, because chelation, there is a possibility of twisting in the bonds. We can't assume any kind of symmetry element in this molecule, so that you can say this molecule is purely optically active, right? And it is chiral in nature. When we go with trans cobalt Cl2En taken twice, trans denotes what? Ethylene diamine, being it is bidentate, these are inclined in the trans position, and chloro also opposite to each other. Let us see the structure of trans ethylene. This is the tris cobalt tris oxalato compound, where you can't find any symmetry element because all the bonds are not present on the same plane. They are twisted, they are tilted in such a manner where steric strain got minimized. That's why you can say this is optically active and is chiral in nature. Right? So no symmetry element can found in this molecule. This is the first compound. Let us go with second compound, where trans cobalt En and Cl2 was given. Right? So ethylene diamine, being it is a bidentate, able to form a chelate ring in this manner. And trans compound, they mentioned trans. Trans in the sense both are opposite to each other. And even chloro also both are opposite to each other. If you bisect the molecule in a horizontal manner, if we insert a hypothetical horizontal plane in this molecule, you can bisect into two identical halves of this molecule. Hence, there is a possibility of the sigma plane. Sigma horizontal plane is possible. If you bisect the molecule vertically, if you put a vertical plane in this molecule, what happens? That vertical plane also bisect the molecule into identical halves. So that this is purely symmetrical, and consequently, you can say it is optically active molecule and is set, optically inactive molecule and is a chiral. This is not a chiral, being it is in trans orientation and symmetrically, symmetrically inclined ligands are present within the molecule. And let us go with third molecule. What is that? So chromium, which is surrounded with EDTA. What is mean by EDTA? Ethylene diamine acid is said to be EDTA molecule. Right? So here is the central metal chromium surrounded by EDTA in this manner. EDTA composed of ethylene CH2, diamine, two amino functional groups are there, four acetic acid moieties. Tetraacetic acid denotes what? Four acetic acid units are present within the molecule. Each oxygen of this terminal center, it is able to form a coordinate covalent bond, and even two nitrogens are able to coordinate so that it will become a hexadentate ligand. It able to form a octahedral compound around this, and the hexadentate ligand. Six electron pairs released from 4 from oxygens, 2 from nitrogen atoms are possible, right? So if you put a vertical plane, horizontal plane, any center of symmetry, if you assume any kind of symmetry element, may not be possible within this, because the molecule is a non-symmetric, hence you can't find any symmetry element. Subsequently, it is the optically active compound and there is a chirality, right? So whenever the cobalt OH taken, thrice was taken, being it is chelating ligand, all the ligands are chelation, participated in the chelation, so that there is a twisting of bonds are possible and you can't find any symmetry element in cobalt OH taken thrice. Trans cobalt Cl2N taken twice, all symmetry elements are present, hence it is a chiral. Third molecule, EDTA, being it is hexadentate, able to form a octahedral complex around the central chromium, so that there is no any symmetry element. Subsequently, chirality is present here. Option number A, C having chirality. A, C are provided in option number 4. For question number 81, option number 4 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 82. When you see question number 82, it is the part of spectroscopic analytical method. Mass bar spectrum of metals gives information about the. So mass bar spectrum, so what is the purpose of mass bar spectrum? First, let us see a brief applications of mass bar spectrum. Mass spectrum is very essential for structure elucidation of the compounds, both organic as well as inorganic compound. Structural interpretation is possible by this spectral analysis process. Oxidation and spin state of a spin of metal can be predicted by using this. Type of ligand coordinated to the central metal, whether it is a weak field ligand or strong field ligand, kind of analysis also possible by using this mass bar analysis. Geometry around the metal, whether it is linear or trigonal bipyramidal, tetrahedral, square planar, octahedral, pentagonal, bipyramidal, whatever the geometry present around the central metal can be easily depicted by using this spectral analysis. Metabolite pathway of the drug, how drug is going to metabolize and how it is functioning, everything can be analyzed by using this mass bar spectroscopy. And even in the forensic analysis, this kind of mass spectroscopy can be used in order to predict that the fingerprints. And next is about in pharmaceutical analysis, drug development and drug discovery. New drug discovery. So what is the drug compound which is synthesized from the laboratory that can be predicted? And even modification of drug also we can analyze by using this spectroscopic analytical method. These are the few spectral applications of mass bar. Then from this data, let us see which statements are correct. Oxidation and spin of the metal can be predicted. It is the correct statement. And next is about type of ligand coordinated to the metal. So whether it is strong or weak field ligand, we can easily interpret by using this analysis. Nuclear spin state of the metal. Nuclear spin is purely related with NMR spectroscopy. Nuclear spin can be depicted, nuclear resonance can be depicted by NMR rather than mass spectroscopy. Option C is the wrong answer. Option D, geometry of the metal can be conveniently interpreted by using this mass bar spectroscopy. For question number 82, A, B, D are the correct statements. A, B, D are provided in option number 3. So 82, option number 3 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 83. For uranosine, the correct statements are, okay. So uranosine is the complex which is formed by uranium and bounded to cyclooctatetraenide ligand. Right here, 8-membered ring system with how many? 4 pi bonds are present within the molecule. This is a kind of system, uranosine, where uranium exists in the form of +4 oxidation state. Here uranium +4 oxidation state will be there. And what is the arrangement? Uranium cyclooctatetraene all are arranged in the linear manner. Hence the molecule existing in the linear. So it is not the bent molecule. Then entire complex is not assigned with any kind of formal charge on this. Charge may not be present. So it is a neutral compound. Okay. So from this data, let us see which are the correct statements. Oxidation state of uranium is +4. That is the correct one. It has cyclooctatetraenide ligand. This is also correct one. These are called cyclooctatetraenide ligands. It is bent sandwich compound is a wrong one. It is a linear sandwich compound. It has -2 charge. No, it is the neutral compound. Option A, B are the correct statements with respect to uranosine, right? So A, B are provided in option number 1. For question number 83, option number 1 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 84. Again, it is a part of inorganic chemistry. The final product of the reaction of carbonyl metallates, vanadium hexacarbonyl uninegative charge and cobalt tetracarbonyl uninegative charge with phosphoric acid respectively. When we are going to treat this vanadium carbonyl, cobalt carbonyl with the phosphoric acid, what are the corresponding products we have to depict? Okay, so let us see what are the correct products for this one. Vanadium hexacarbonyl minus is treated with H3PO4. H3PO4 is treated here. H3PO4 is the oxidizing agent, right? So oxidizing agent, what it will do, it used to convert, it is +4, not +3. Sorry for this. H3PO4 is called phosphoric acid. H3PO3 is called phosphorus acid. So within the problem, they mentioned it is the phosphoric acid, right? So phosphoric acid should be taken here. So it is a phosphoric acid compound. So upon treating with phosphoric acid, vanadium hexacarbonyl minus turned into vanadium hexacarbonyl. What happened here? -1 charge is there, here 0 charge is there. Means electron got removed from the system. The process is called oxidation. And here, phosphoric acid is working like an oxidizing agent. It is working like an oxidizing agent. In the second case, cobalt CO taken for minus treated with H3PO4. Right? So, in case of this one, phosphoric acid is releasing H+. Phosphoric acid is releasing H+, so that it turned into HCOCO taken 4. In the second case, phosphoric acid is working like a Bronsted acid and releasing H+, and there is a formation of a neutral compound here. Neutral compound got generated in this case. So here, vanadium hexacarbonyl neutral and HCOCO taken 4, these are the corresponding products whenever these carbonyl compounds are treated with phosphoric acid. These are provided in option number 1. For question number 84, option number 1 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 85. The correct statement about substitution reaction of cobalt CN taken 5 Cl minus 3 with OH minus to give cobalt CN 5 OH minus 3 is. So, what we are doing, we are taking the starting material treated with OH minus. Now, chloro replaced with hydroxide. This is a kind of nucleophilic substitution and generally proceeded with unimolecular nucleophilic substitution, being it is a SN1 kind of reaction. When cobalt CN taken by Cl minus 3 was taken, so initially it got dissociated. So, it got dissociated so that cobalt CN taken 5 plus Cl minus will be generated. This is a kind of SN1 mechanism, unimolecular nucleophilic substitution, where a rate determining step is nothing but slow step, decomposition of starting material so that trigonal bipyramidal geometry containing intermediate compound was originated. This compound further, this is the next step, second step being SN1 is the multi-step process. In the second step, OH minus will be added to the central cobalt so that here a substituted product, substituted OH substituted product got generated here, right? So this is a kind of mechanism which is proceeded with SN1. Rate of the reaction directly depends upon the concentration of CO, CN taken 5, Cl minus 3. Why? Because in rate determining step, in the slow step, only one reactant got participated, that is a cobalt complex rather than OH minus. It is not a bimolecular, right? And what is the intermediate geometry? Intermediate being it is five coordinated complex, you can say trigonal bipyramidal geometry will be there rather than pentagonal bipyramidal. Five coordinated cobalt complexities, right? So, and rate of the reaction directly depends upon the concentration of cobalt complex. Now let us see, based on this mechanism, what are the correct statements? It obeys first order kinetics, exactly, being it is the kind of SN1, only concentration of cobalt complex will influence the rate of reaction, hence it is a kind of first order kinetics. That is the correct statement. Rate is proportional to the concentration of both reactants. No, rate only depends upon the concentration of COC, CN taken by Cl minus 3 rather than OH minus. OH minus will be attached in the first step. It is not RDS. And next, it follows SN1 conjugate base mechanism. No, it is the simple SN1 mechanism, unimolecular nucleophilic substitution rather than conjugate base mechanism. Its rate depends only on the concentration of OH minus. It doesn't depend upon OH minus concentration. Only the correct answer is first order kinetics. For question number 85, option number 1 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 86. Aqueous chromium plus 2 affects one electron reduction of cobalt NH3 taken by Cl plus 2 giving compound Y. Compound Y undergoes rapid hydrolysis. What is Y here? So when you see cobalt NH3 taken by Cl plus 2 compound was given, it is treated with chromium plus 2 complex. So one electron reduction is possible. It will be proceeded with electron transfer mechanism. Electron transfer is basically classified into two types. One is inner sphere mechanism. Second is outer sphere mechanism. Inner sphere mechanism in the sense, if the mechanism proceeded with bridging ligand, when chloro ligand is there, then it facilitates the inner sphere mechanism bridging ligand, being it work like a bridging ligand and mechanism is with the inner sphere. Whenever two reactant got reacted and the product will be distincted without any interference, that is called outer sphere mechanism. But it is a kind of inner sphere in a electron transfer reaction proceeded with the bridging chloro group. It able to form a bridge between now let us see the exact mechanism for this. Cobalt NH3 taken by Cl dipositive can be treated with chromium H2O taken 6 dipositive. Cobalt complex, it is a inert complex. Cobalt plus 2 is said to be inert in nature, being it is attached with cobalt plus 3, not plus 2 here, because here chlorine is also there. Entire charge in the cobalt will be plus 3. Here chromium is plus 2 and it exists in labile complex. What is inert? What is labile? Inert is nothing but its reactivity is very less and the reaction towards any reagent will be very difficult, is called inert. Labile in the sense easily, conveniently replaced with other ligands and participate in reaction in the very well manner. So that is called labile. Whenever these two got reacted by the elimination of one of the water molecule, they got reacted in a manner of bridging reaction with a chloro group. Being chloro is a bridging ligand, it able to form a bridge. And here electrons will be transported from one metal to another through inner sphere mechanism because one electron reduction reaction is possible, right? Now, chromium complex is attaining chlorine because chlorine now attached with the chromium and it became inert. Now, chromium converted into plus 3, cobalt converted into plus 2. Cobalt plus 3 to plus 2, so that inert complex now converted into labile complex, that is called Y. This is a compound what we are expecting in the problem. So we have to predict this compound Y only. Further, this will be treated with water. It's subjected to water hydrolysis. What happens being it is a labile, easily replaced with the ligands of water, so that cobalt hexaaqua compound was formed. But within the problem, they are asking that what is the compound Y? What is compound Y? Cobalt NH3 taken 5 plus 2, that is a labile compound. Cobalt NH3 taken 5 plus 2 is given in the option number 1. For question number 86, option number 1 is the correct answer. Okay, let us move on to question number 87. The reaction of boron trichloride with ammonium chloride gives compound A, which upon reduction with sodium borohydride gives a product B. Product B upon reacting with hydrochloric acid. Right. The reaction of boron trichloride with ammonium chloride gives the product A, which upon reduction with sodium borohydride gives product B. Product B upon reacting with hydrochloric acid upwards compound C, which is, okay, so with HCl upwards compound C, which is, so we have to predict what is the reaction and what will be the final product. So we are taking the combination of boron trichloride with ammonium chloride. 3 moles, 1:3 ratio BCl3 treated with ammonium chloride. There is a formation of structure which resembles a benzene. So here boron nitrogen are alternatively arranged and alternative bond system will be there. And being it is attached with chloro, it is a trichloroboron trichloride compound was generated, right? So now it is treated with the sodium borohydride. What is the purpose of sodium borohydride? It is the mild reducing agent used to react with all the chloro and reduction of these groups and converted into hydrogens. Initially, trichloro compound is there. Now it turned into hexahydro compound. All boron nitrogen now attached with the hydrogens only. Further, it is treated with 3 moles of HCl again. Whenever 3 moles of HCl was given, it participate in the addition reaction. Just like benzene participate addition reaction with chlorine in the presence of sunlight to give gamaxine, right? In the similar manner, here also this compound is treated with hydrochloric acid. Addition product is generated so that here we will get, what is the composition? How many borons are there? How many nitrogens are there? N3. How many chloride? Right? Yes. Boron trichloride, when treated with ammonium chloride, compound A, a cyclic product. Sodium borohydride, completely reduced product. Then finally, B will be treated with HCl. There is a possibility of Cl3, B3, N3, H9. That is given in the option number 1. For question number 87, option number 1 is the correct answer. Right, the number of valency electrons provided by ruthenium CO taken thrice fragment towards cluster bonding. How many electrons boron hydrogen is associated with 2 electrons with a spin parity, and whenever metals like iron, ruthenium, osmium, all this belongs to D6 category, and this D6 kind of electrons will have the spin parallel state. So now there is an isolobal analogy with boron hydride with metal tricarbonyl like. Right, so here boron is associated with 3 electrons. H minus is there, it compensated with 1 electron, so that leftover electrons in the boron will be 2. So being it is